The following video features materials protected by the Fair Use Guidelines of Section 107 of the Copyright Act. All rights reserved to the Creative Commons.
Hello, welcome to Analysing Sound. Have you ever wondered how the sound of your favourite TV shows or clips or memes was produced? This is a series where I analyse the sound of various films, TV shows, movies and more and find out exactly that. Finding subtle details, conjuring theories and finding interesting facts, starting from the humble microphone, the unique acoustic environments of each set, all the way to the post-production studio. Let's take a look at the fantastic series called Breaking Bad, specifically the use of different microphone types and added sounds. There's a high likelihood you've probably already seen this show, considering it's won numerous awards, reached widespread critical acclaim, and is still extremely popular even today. Breaking Bad follows the moral descent of a man who goes from having the confidence of a saggy bag of potatoes to a dangerous criminal capable of murder without much consideration. From a high school chemistry teacher to a dangerous drug kingpin. The evolution of the main character entails tons of dramatic scenes, tons of explosions, and huel. All of which make up some pretty interesting acoustic situations. So let's dive in and find some interesting facts about the sound behind Breaking Bad. Vince Gilligan is the creator of Breaking Bad as well as Better Call Saul, which is Breaking Bad's prequel series. Numerous directors and writers were employed to write and direct each episode, something which is standard in the industry. However, Vince, as the creator, of course, had a large influence upon the artistic direction of the overall series. An integral person responsible for sound production in the series was the Emmy-nominated sound production mixer Darryl Frank. He worked on the pilot for the series before working on from season 3. In an interview of him discussing the various challenges for sound production in the series, he stated that Vince Gilligan wanted the dialogue of the show to be as realistic as possible, doing this through including dialogue overlapping from actors, which is essentially just including actors speaking over each other's lines, and small sounds from the set as well. This is something that is slightly uncommon compared to many other shows, as Darryl states, which often have perfect cuts in the dialogue without imperfections. This in itself presents some clear problems or challenges for even recording sound in the show, because not only must the dialogue from the actors be clear, but also the sound from the set as well. To do this, Darryl Frank along with his team employed the use of two main microphone types, again something that isn't uncommon. As he details in an interview, if there was dialogue on the scene, they always ran wire microphones. In addition to wires though, they also used boom microphones, microphones that are hung by an operator. They also recorded sound from the camera boom, a microphone that is placed close to the camera to record additional sound from the set, including dialogue overlapping. And so they use wire microphones to record dialogue, but what is a wire microphone and why should you use it? It's also known as the lavalier microphone, which is a tiny little microphone that can capture sound discreetly. It can usually be placed on clothing, it can also be easily hidden with the right techniques, which results in it often being used for discreet recording of dialogue from actors, or for secretly recording the confessions of a criminal. What makes the microphone especially cool is that it has an omnidirectional polar pattern. This means that it can record all the way around it. It can be clipped or taped onto many different spots on the body while still capturing clear dialogue, independent from where the microphone head is pointing. We see the lavalier microphone being used in the show literally. When Walter White spills his stomach contents onto the dry Albuquerque sand, after giving two rival criminals a leisurely joyride, we see the transmitter for the microphone actually outlining through his shirt. The transmitter sends the sound captured from the microphone wirelessly to a receiver, meaning Walter can move freely around the scene without having to be conscious of cables or moving away from microphones which are hung or placed on the set or location. This is especially important considering many of the locations in Breaking Bad take space in large mountainous areas where traversal isn't easy or in tight spots where space isn't readily available, like a pest control garage or a recreational vehicle. Many of the locations just aren't that well suited for having additional operators to follow the actors around with large heavy microphones. Albuquerque, where the show took place, is also known for turbulent winds due to the hot surface of the arid deserts, allowing air at the ground to rise and mix with the cold, stronger winds aloft. Lavalier microphones are often covered by clothing when hidden, protecting them from these turbulent winds, which would otherwise destroy any recordings through microphone roughing. Although this isn't as big of a factor as you might think though, as normal microphones can also be protected by wind by simply using a windshield, which is those like little fuzzy looking things you often see at the end of the microphone head. There's one small problem with lavalier microphones though. The fact that they're omnidirectional means that they'll not only pick up the intended sound, but also unwanted sounds in the vicinity. A man revving his Toyota Corolla a little bit too hard, a screaming child, or a fleet of military attack helicopters flying overhead is all it takes to destroy what would otherwise be a perfect take. This is especially relevant in many of the locations of Breaking Bad, as Darryl Frank explains. Most of the locations in the show were pretty crap, often without electricity, including a pest control garage that sat right beside one of the busiest streets in Albuquerque, an airport, and a military base. For this reason, the production team for Breaking Bad not only used lavalier microphones, but also boom microphones, which are more like traditional microphones, except on a stick. What makes them special though, is that they're often much more directional, with a cardioid or supercardioid polar pattern. This means that the microphone captures most sound right where the microphone is pointing, picking up more of the intended sound and less of the background. You can think of it sort of like a spotlight, where wherever the light is pointing is where the microphone captures most sound. This is especially important in the context of many of the locations of Breaking Bad, which were often in areas with lots of naturally occurring ambient noise from traffic or attack helicopters. In the behind the scenes footage from the show, there are a lot of examples of boom microphones being used for various functions, including distant recording of dialogue to capture more of the room in the sets, the reverberations and echoing coming from the actor's dialogue reflecting around the space, and for recording small details on the set like chairs squeaking and dogs barking and so on. So there are trade-offs of using each microphone type, and such it's actually common for production teams to use both microphones at the same time. This is to be able to choose which microphone suits each given situation, or blend both takes together to get a sound that consolidates the acoustic qualities from each microphone type, which is what the sound from the production team of Breaking Bad did. Boom microphones tend to be a bit more natural and better sounding compared to lavalier microphones, as they're placed in an ideal location to the actor's mouth, and are much more focused in where they capture sound. However, they require operators to follow actors around, and as such might not be so well suited for small, tight spaces or big mountainous areas. Lavalier microphones are discreet, can capture dialogue clearly, and are often wireless, making them ideal for locations where traversal isn't easy or if space is tight. However, the sound is often much more unnatural compared to booms, as lavalier microphones are often placed behind clothing at a less than ideal angle in relation to the mouth of the speaker. So recording the sound for a show like Breaking Bad takes some serious thought into what sort of microphones you should use in each given situation, considering the show takes place in many different locations, each with their own logistical and acoustic characteristics. Speaking of acoustic characteristics, what's really interesting about the sound of Breaking Bad is that many of the sounds you actually hear aren't actually there on set, but are actually added later on. Many of the ambient sounds containing those cricket sounding things and birds tweeting and distant sounds like dogs barking are most of the time added in post-production rather than actually recorded on the scene. This isn't something that's necessarily unique to Breaking Bad, and is actually more of a common practice. Adding ambience to a scene will always allow much more control of its sound level and timing than if the ambience was pre-baked into the dialogue itself or recorded while the actors are performing. Moreover, many locations in Breaking Bad took place beside noisy areas like a bloody airport, meaning the natural ambience of these locations might be pretty bad in comparison to the tailored, added sounds the sound producers used in post-production. There are also quite a lot of scenes where you'd think the sound was actually there on set, but actually isn't, or is at least heavily altered compared to the original sound. In the first episode in season 3, a scene takes place in a gymnasium in the advent of a fictional plane crash which Walter White, one can argue, indirectly caused. In the scene, high schoolers and school staff pass around a wireless microphone that feeds to a speaker system to talk about the horrors and trauma caused by the crash.
Because of all the horrors, you know, we perceived.
Though what's really interesting about the scene is that the acoustic environment, the gymnasium, which would have lots of echo and reverberation from the hard surfaces reflecting the sound from the speaker system in the space, is most likely reproduced rather than actually faithfully recorded. The effect that this acoustic environment would cause on the system that's amplifying the talker's voice is simulated in post-production with artificial echoing and reverberation instead. Like, if you look at a wide shot of the scene, there's literally no speakers to be found. If you're listening to this video on headphones, you hear the echoing coming from the talker's voice pinging back and forth in the stereo field, which is pretty unrealistic compared to how this environment would really sound if recorded with actual microphones.
I guess what I would want to say is to look on the bright side.
So this effect is most likely added in post-production rather than actually recorded in the scene. Although this is just a theory. You would hardly ever think this when watching the show unless you're really super anal about the sound of each scene and intentionally trying to find faults and nitpick the audio.
So, plus, neither plane was full.
Speaking of audio, yes, I'm really stretching that transition here. Explosions. Breaking Bad has quite a lot of them. While they're often visually enhanced with CGI and VFX, the sound of many of the explosions in Breaking Bad, such as when Gus Fring, the main antagonist, has his face blown off, are almost entirely altered or replaced compared to the original sound from the simulated explosions on set. A real explosion often sounds much less impressive compared to a Hollywood explosion, often being more of a thunderclap than a deep dramatic explosive sound. The replacement or heavy alteration of the sound on the set allows the explosions to be audibly beefed up to meet the audience's expectations. Usually through adding additional sound to the existing explosion, layering new sounds together, or entirely replacing the original explosion with a new one. We actually hear this in the behind the scenes footage for Gus Fring's death, where the explosions in that footage is comparatively meek compared to the big beefy explosion in the actual show. Although some sound from the actual explosion may have also been used, as we see a tiny little dynamic microphone in the behind the scenes footage recording the sound from the set. It's so cute. So there, you have some interesting facts and details behind the sound of Breaking Bad. If you haven't seen the show already, you should, because it's really good and there's lots of funny memes that you will finally understand once you see the show. Keep in mind that some of the theories in the show are based on loose speculation with analysis. Some details in this video might be slightly different to how the sound was actually recorded. However, I hope you found this video interesting and valuable in some way. And if you want to see more of this type of content, feel free to subscribe to this channel and hit the notifications button that sort of looks like a bell. Okay, salutations and goodbye.